So without further ado, our near and dear, Twyla Dell.
Thank you so much. I love being called dear. Holy cow, how often does that happen? And women, mothers, can we do it?
We can.
All right, let's do better than that. We can do it, everybody. We can do it. One more time. We can do it. It's no accident. It's not a good thing that we lost, but don't take me there. Okay. We're going to talk about mothers and daughters this morning, specifically brave mothers and accomplished daughters. How many of you have a brave mother? Huh? You can immediately think of times when your mother was brave in the face of adversity of one kind or another. It happens that five accomplished daughters this morning are going to talk to us about those brave mothers. So, first thing we're going to find out as how this story started. Oh, before I start, I have to tell you two things. One is that, please hold your applause until we're all finished. And two, God, I forgot it. It'll come to me. Okay. July 29th is when our story started, when Hillary Clinton was nominated by the Democratic Party for president. We were so excited. Those of us who'd been waiting a lifetime for a woman president, we were finally rewarded. And her last statement on the stage of the Democratic Convention was, "I am my mother's daughter and my daughter's mother." And we thought, this was something we could work with. My friends and I thought, how could we help Hillary? We would take this statement and do something with it. And 8 weeks later, we published a book, I became a publisher, and it contained 9 stories, 9 different women whose mothers had been heroic and whose daughters had become accomplished. Have these stories in this book that you can get at the back of the room. If you run out of copies, there's a postcard that will give you the information. This picture is an iconic picture from my family. The girl on the left is my mother at the age of 10 and my grandmother at the age of 30. They are in California here. You can see that by the lush background. And they are refugees, not illegal aliens, but refugees from Philadelphia. This is 1918 and the Spanish flu is decimating the East Coast. 3,000 people a week were dying of the flu in Philadelphia. That is a true fact, not an alternative fact, and you can look it up. And they had all gone sick with it and then recovered and found out they could move to California and get away from it, and they did. So here they are. And my family lived in Los Angeles the rest of their lives, and I was born there. Now, my grandmother is 30 years old. It's 1918. She would not be able to vote until 1920 when the women got the vote. That's just a little piece of history there. So 2020, women, we're going to put on a big show, are we not? So the stories were written around a mother's piece of advice. And I'm sure as soon as I say that, you'll remember some piece of advice your mother told you, right? And it isn't keep your underwear clean. It's something bigger than that. So here is my mother and her advice. When a door opens, run through it. She was a very pretty young woman, very musically talented. She worked as a secretary and had had a lovely childhood, evangelical childhood, with Christian music running through the family. And so the first big door that she walked through was to marry my father. And here she is standing in virginal bliss, unaware of the fact that she is going to be a battered bride. My father was a very charming, agreeable, well-spoken, well-dressed, the kind of man that people said, wow, isn't she lucky? But she was not lucky. And so for 5 years, she put up with his unpredictable rages to the point that she had to sleep with a butcher knife under her pillow to keep him away. And 5 years later, my brave mother divorced him with a toddler and a babe in arms. Now that was brave, was it not? A lot of women would have stayed, and she said, no, that's enough. Now my father had married right away. He had had a woman on the side. He was planning this. He went to court and persuaded the court that a stay-at-home stepmother was a better home with him working than a single working mother whose parents were taking care of the kids. And the court agreed. And the court gave him custody of us kids, and she didn't see us for several years. When we got to her again, we were together only a few weeks, and the long arm of the law was trying to get us away from her again. We jumped on a train in the middle of the day, and we went to Oregon from Los Angeles. And we hid out in Oregon where my grandparents had bought a little farm, 10 acres and a cabin, and we stayed there beyond the law. So here we are in Oregon, and here I am at the age of 10. Like my mother had been a refugee at the age of 10 from the flu, I was a refugee from my father's erratic temper. So my mother on the left, her brother, my uncle next, my grandparents, my brother, and me. Now, the unlikeliest of kids to go to college, because we had this kind of childhood, was we were able to go because of these two women, my mother and my grandmother. They were readers, and they talked about what they read. My mother liked biography, my grandmother liked history, and they talked all the time about that we were reading. They would read passages aloud. They would, you know, it was an enthusiastic milieu in which every big idea was explored. My grandmother was a great biblical scholar, and so my brother and I did the same thing. And so we grew up reading and talking, and what is college after all about reading and talking, right? If you can't read and you can't discuss, you're not going to do well in college. So here we were. Now, this is a Swedish family, and 10 years later, I would be a bilingual college student in Mexico City. No one could have predicted that here. And I didn't get Spanish until I was in high school. I was good at it. Who knew? I surprised myself. I was very good at it. And I decided to go to Mexico City, and this was a door that I walked through based on my mother's own bravery. And I graduated from college in Mexico City, University of the Americas, and my brother eventually, after 2 years in the Navy, and the GI Bill, graduated from San Francisco State. Two unlikely students with this kind of background. But before we can get to college, we have to get through high school. And this was my home. We left Oregon. We couldn't make enough money in Oregon, even though on the farm, we fed the pigs, milked the cows, fed the chickens, ate the chickens, canned. How many of you have that background, farm background? You know what it's like, don't you? Work all the time. Good work. So we moved back to California. We had no money. We had no child support, ever. Nobody could make my father pay child support, and he didn't. So we lived in this little trailer. We had no running water, no electricity at first. We had an outhouse back here. My brother slept in the tent, and my mother and I slept on the pull-out sofa in the kitchen. In fact, my mother and I slept together my entire youth. And 2 years of college, I didn't get to have my own bed, and I never had my own bedroom. I never even had a bed. I slept on a sofa my entire life until I went away to school in Mexico City. And how my mother managed to get dressed every day and go to work as a secretary for the state of California out of this place, I just don't know how she did it. But she did. Brave mother. Finally, she married again to a fellow musician. And she spent the remaining years of her life with her little band playing around Southern California, played at the Mary, the Queen Mary ship in Long Beach at the port for 10 years on New Year's Eve, and she died happy. And that was because she got a man who was supportive. So, what did we need? We needed child support badly, and didn't get it. And we just lived a very meager life. But we knew how to read, we knew how to talk, and we were hard as nails. And because of a brave mother and grandmother, we were able to accomplish what we did. Now, I am going to introduce my friend Janie Frederick, who is one of our authors. Janie is a licensed Unity minister, which is where we met. And also, she has a BA degree from Avila University in accounting, something I'd never be able to do. I can't count at all. And she is a certified public accountant with her own practice and a husband and two teenage children. Teenage children, wave. Yes, that's a full plate, is it not? A very full plate. Please welcome Janie. Hold your applause.
Thank you, Twyla. Mm-hmm. I have no idea if there are pictures here of my family or not. Are there? Are there pictures here of mine or not?
Yes, there are.
Okay.
All right, here is your mother and her advice.
Yes. Okay. If you're going to make a mistake, make it loud. So this is a recurring theme. The mother and the mother of a daughter and a family and wondering how in the heck our parents did it, how my mother did what she did. And I remember sitting at the dining room table, listening to the radio. Hold on to your hats, folks. I am woman, hear me roar, in numbers too big to ignore, and I know too much to go back and pretend. 'Cause I've heard it all before, and I've been down there on the floor, oh, pardon me. And no one's ever gonna keep me down again. Oh, yes, I am wise, but it's wisdom born of pain. Yes, I've paid the price, but look how much I've gained. If I have to, I can do anything. I am wise, I am invincible, I am woman. And I see all these women out here singing it with me, you guys. So not only did we listen to it on the radio, but that song, I had the sheet music for it. My mother and I would stand at the piano and sing it. And that was, you know, that was who my mother was. That was how I grew up. It was born out of her generation. That song, I think Helen Reddy was about my mother's age, but it was the theme song of my generation. And I remember hearing that song, the Sex and the City, the second movie, I think, they sang that. They were in Dubai or something like that, and they were singing that song. And I had tears in my eyes then. So anyway, if you're going to make a mistake, make it loud. So my mother got off a train in Boise, Idaho. She grew up in South Dakota, was abandoned by her husband after having a baby. She followed him to Las Vegas on the train, went after him, found herself in a seedy hotel with a baby, and was told to kind of turn around and leave, that it wasn't a safe place for her or the baby. And instead of getting back on the train and heading all the way back to South Dakota, she got off the train in Boise, Idaho. She just got off the train with a baby in tow in 1948 and raised a child on her own, got a job. You know, she made a big mistake, but she made it loud. And I know I only have 5 minutes. Twyla said make it 5 minutes, so I'm gonna make it quick here. I had no idea I was gonna sit here and cry. So this is my mother, this is my sister, this the young lady here is my sister who was the baby in tow, and then this is my brother and I. Let's see where we're at. This is my mother in her professional career. She went back to school, she got a job, she worked as a secretary, she ended up going back to school, and has had 2 degrees, a degree in music, a degree in theater, and was working on her master's in musical theater when she passed away. And they gave it to her posthumously because she died before she was able to finish the master's degree. She always wanted to be a musician, and so she ended up doing that. Okay, you'll have to pardon me. I'm gonna tell you a little bit of, I was watching a movie, I was about 40 years old, maybe 42 or 43, and it's a movie I think everybody here probably is aware of. It was Look Who's Coming to Dinner, or Who's Coming to Dinner, with Katharine Hepburn, Spencer Tracy, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, and Sidney Poitier. And I'm listening to this story, this monologue. Katharine Hepburn is talking, and it's this monologue, and I'm thinking, I've heard this monologue before. And I'm transported back to my kitchen table, and my mother having a conversation with me. She's lecturing me. And I'm remembering the things that she was talking about, and it was political, and I just thought my mother was so wise. And I just thought, wow, she's so wise, she knows so much. But as I'm watching the show, I realized those were the exact words Katharine Hepburn was saying to I think she was talking to Spencer Tracy. And that was, okay. So now I have to kind of take my mother off the pedestal. She isn't as wise, no, but you know what? She is that wise. She made those words her words. Helen Reddy, I made those words my words. That's what the Women's March is all about. The whole point of that for me is that no matter what happens in this culture in the next 4 years or 8 years or whatever this political situation brings us into our culture, Helen Reddy, Spencer Tracy, Katharine Hepburn, Sidney Poitier, Twyla Dell, Twyla's mother, Nancy Kramer, who I'm going to introduce here in a minute. It's born in us. It is something that can't be taken away. It is enculturated in us. Our society has grown to a point. You can make alternative news all you want. You can suppress the press, but you can't change history. You can't change those words that we were just ready to say. That woman that got off the train in 1948 with a baby and made a life. A woman who made the challenge to get divorced in 1940. You can't change it. You just can't. So anyway, thank you for having me. This was the last picture here. This is my mother. She spent the last years of her life performing on cruise ships and having a blast and made a living at it. She just was awesome. Anyway, worked as a secretary. So the next woman that I'm going to introduce to you here is Nancy Kramer. Nancy Kramer is one of my heroes. She has a Bachelor of Journalism from the University of Missouri at Columbia. She also has some advanced degrees. She was a business owner. She's a teacher. I like to hang out with this group of women. They're pretty awesome women. So here we go. Here is Nancy Kramer.
Thank you very much. I might add that I have written 4 books about World War I. And I'm on my 5th book of that. My story about my mother is a little bit different. We grew up a typical middle-class family. And there are 3 words I would use to describe my mother. Okay, 3 words. They would be stylish, smart, and sociable. My mother, Mary Sproul Jefferson Grief, lived from 1904 to 1972. So she's been gone 45 years, and it was a little hard for me to look back on some of those things. Her earliest advice that I can remember was, Nancy Jo, you're the oldest, so you must set the example. Well, mother, I tried, but there was no one that could equal the example that you set for me, because she had one more trait, and that was determination. She was born in South Texas, the daughter of a small town photographer, and she was photographed continuously. I don't know if my, and as you see this little angel right here, which was the right next button, I don't know. There, okay.
This one.
Of that one, okay. Her photographs included even this hospital bed where I was born, And as you can see, it's far different from hospital beds now today. To glamour shots. My uncle took up the family business, and he wanted to experiment with lighting and with dramatic poses, and my mother loved it. She wears this pink chiffon evening dress studded with diamonds, which she cut off and added to make my first formal dress, yes. But the photos also included the usual family gatherings, PTA gatherings, birthday parties, and such. Now, one thing that she brought to her marriage was her most prized possession, and that was a small baby grand piano. She bought that piano on loans, on time payments, because she worked for a bank. And that's probably the only reason that she was allowed credit, is because they knew they could subtract from her wages if she missed a payment. Women in those days were not allowed to have credit of their own. She wanted to be a classical pianist, and she had to give that up. She was very good. But she played that piano every day of her life. It was one of her most precious things. We lived in a small town in Denton, Texas. My mother had the usual social life of a middle-class woman. Bridge parties, luncheons, get-togethers, and she was very happy there. Then my father was offered an advancement of a job in Amarillo, Texas, where we knew nobody and where the sandstorms rage every single day. And my mother, not too strangely, but she was not happy there. I think she probably went into a period of depression, but of course in those days, that word wasn't even invented. She needed something to do, and she didn't have the usual activities that she had in Denton. So her way out began the day that she won a Ford car that was offered by a grocery store, and she now had four wheels of her own. Now, she had to learn to drive it, and we all did, you know. But now she had her wheels, and I don't know if this was the start of her thinking of her new path in life or just where it was. I was never aware of a great deal of dissension between my parents. You know, middle-class people in those days kept things quiet. But after she got the car, she was offered a job as a manager in a big department store in Amarillo. And she was more than excited. She was enthused about it. My father, however, had been brought up in Iowa of the old stock that you provide for your family and the wife stays home. The wife just would not, it'd be disgraceful for the wife to earn a salary. The next thing I knew, I was away at college and I received a letter from my parents saying they were getting a divorce. Now, I'm not sure how long this dissentiment had been going along, but obviously having a car and turning down the opportunity to be a businesswoman was just too much for her. And my father later regretted it. However, he was not the father that we've been hearing about. He paid the child support, he visited the children. He was a good father. He just wasn't good enough to my mother, that's all. My mother moved to Columbia where I was in school, and I graduated and took a newspaper reporting job in Virginia. And she and my little sister, 10 years old, followed me there. And my mother got a position as the county license agent, which in Virginia, you had to have a lot of political pull to get that. And my mother was brand new to Virginia, so she must have really impressed them with her ability. And she held that job for 20 years until she retired. And she was very, very respected for that. During that time, I married against my mother's wishes. She knew that we were not compatible, but he was on the way to Korea and going to be a hero, and so we got married. And my mother proved that she was right. So now I am a single parent with four children, and my contact with my mother is mostly through letters. Telephone calls were very expensive, as you know. And so we corresponded and became very close during those years, since I was teaching school and having a job, in other words, and being able to get credit on my own. By the way, I always wondered how many tears she shed when she had to sell that and leave that piano behind in Texas. Nevertheless, I recall very vividly the last telephone call that I had from her. She had been in the hospital having tests and nothing was wrong, and they were going to send her home the next day. We had the most loving call of all. But the next morning, quite early in the morning, the hospital called and said my mother had died during the night. I was stunned, but I was determined to remember that call, and I can almost tell you word for word what it was. And what it really said to me was, "Mother, you set the example for me." And I will always remember that. Thank you. I want to introduce our next speaker, Susan Concinci. She holds graduate degrees in guidance and counseling and spent 43 years in education. She enjoys substitute teaching. So this must really be a good talk right now.
Good morning. Well, here she is, Mildred Frances Mertz May. Was born in 1908 in Copley, Pennsylvania, and died in Knoxon, Pennsylvania in 1999. A beautiful woman, an intelligent woman, a brave woman. The lessons that she left me with, and the thing that I remember, and the phrase that comes to mind, is to treat people fairly and love children. And in my sharing this morning, I'm going to be talking about her love of children. Mildred was married in 1928, and at that time she was also 3 months pregnant. And if you go way back in time, this had a very much of a stigma. So she had a lot of guilt about that. In 1929, the stock market crash came, and Mildred lived with poverty and homelessness right there in front of her face. She had five children in a very short period of time, four boys in a row and a girl. Then there was a six-year gap, and she had my sister Carolyn, 3 years me, almost 5 years in my sister Marjorie. And I always wondered what went on with a 6-year period with no children because they're like stair-stepped, right? So I'm thinking, what's the deal? Well, I found out in a very shocking way. When I was 15, my parents were having an argument, and they were in the living room, and I kind of stood up, kind of between them, and for whatever reason, I didn't get hit that time. My dad turned around and walked out of the room to the dining room, and my mother went right after him. And she said to him, "And Tom, you almost ruined me with 15 children." Now, as a 15-year-old, I'm thinking, what the heck? There's only 8 kids in our family. What is going on? So later that night, I asked her. I was a very talkative and curious child. I think I drove her nuts. Anyway, I said, "Mom, what's the deal?" And she became very solemn. And she said, "Susan," she said, "I had 5 children. And then," she said, "I had all these babies, and I didn't know what to do." You have to remember, birth control, only prophylactics. My father wouldn't use them. Okay? So we look at choices, right? So she told me, "I did something I never thought I would do because I love children so much." She self-aborted 7 children in that 6-year period. So here am I. "Well, how'd you do it, Mom?" Right? And she says to me, "I took slippery elm and another herb, which I cannot recall." And she said, "Aunt Elsie helped me." And she said, "This is what I did." She said, "I didn't know what else to do. The depth of the depression, what do you do?" And I think she experienced out of that physical trauma, emotional trauma, psychological trauma, and most of all for her, spiritual trauma. Okay? Now, she also did something that in later years I had to do some work with. She said, "Susan, I don't want anyone to know about this. You cannot tell your brothers or your sisters." And she said, "I never want to talk about it again." And through my experiences and my learning in the guidance and counseling field, you know, I found out that many people do that. They'll set the boundaries in order for protection. And that's what my mother was doing. I really didn't tell anyone in my family until I was in my 50s, and I told my sisters. My brothers to this day don't know about that. But out of that also comes bravery. She tended her other children and took care of them, but that was lasting with her. She always referred to those times as her miscarriages, but I knew a different story with that. And it's one of survival. It's how do you take care of yourself when you might lose your home, when you might not be able to feed the 5 children that you have in front of you? What choices do you make? My mother had a wonderful sense of humor. She had a wonderful nature about her, and I think this was so challenging for her. Now, if we look ahead, my youngest sister, and here's this beautiful woman, striking. Here she is at 83. And here she is with my little sister, Marjorie. Now, Marjorie, when she was 20, also married a very abusive man and beat her very badly, and she went home to my mother and also told my mother that she was pregnant. So as times change, and we lived in Pennsylvania, my mother said to her, "Do you want to raise this child or do you want an abortion? Because if you want an abortion, I'll make it happen for you." Okay? So she did. She took her to New York State, which in 1971, abortion was legal. Pennsylvania, it wasn't. $500. Now, I don't know about you, but to me, being retired, $500 is a lot of money, okay? So in 1971, she's able to do this legally for her daughter. And what a blessing, because later Marjorie married a wonderful man and had a wonderful family, wonderful daughter. She now has 5 grandchildren. And I don't know what her life would have been like if she would have made another choice. So we're talking about bravery here. We're talking about survival. We're talking about love for children. So what did my mother really need? She needed medical services and she needed legal support, okay, for her to be successful and to love her children. Now, because we're talking about what our mothers also did from the standpoint of education, I'd like to share with you that I had a dream. When I was in third grade, I knew I wanted to be a teacher. Oh, it was so great. You know, I used to get kids around at recess time and be the teacher. I can't even believe they did that, but they did. So she could have said to me, Susan, you're going to be working in a factory. Just put that dream out of your mind. You'll never be able to go to college. But she didn't. She encouraged that all the way through school. And when I was a senior in high school, she asked one of my brothers if they would help me out financially to go to college. And one of them stepped up and did it. So that's what opened a door for me. So this woman that I love so dearly and meant so much to me had a big influence in being the teacher that I became, being the counselor that I became, and the woman that I am today. Thank you. Here, I'm forgetting my other person. Come on up. This is Melody Armstrong. And I just met Melody yesterday, so forgive me for forgetting you here. Melody is a graduate of Tulane University. She is a physician, and she's involved in medical research. And she's here to talk with you about the Women's March and some other things. Here you go.
Thank you so much. There's a saying that we all can see far because we stand on the shoulders of giants. And I can't tell you how humbling it is to see the stories of the ladies on whose shoulders we all stand. We have to think how different those stories would have been had Twyla's mom had the financial support that she needed, and Janie's mom as well. If Nancy's mom had had the moral support, what her story would have looked like, and Susan's mom, the legal support that would have let her move on. So I woke up the morning after the election with quite a bit of shock, a little dismay, a little bit of fear, and looking for a direction. I heard from friends about this Women's March, maybe, in D.C. A couple of women were throwing a block party. And 2 weeks ago, they did, and the world showed up. We had 3 million women around the world and men on the streets. Somewhere over 500,000 in D.C., because we now live in a world where size matters. 167 sister marches across the U.S. In December, I was talking with Twyla about a picture she was painting, because on top of being a PhD, she's an author and an artist. And I said, you know, there's this march in D.C., would you like to go? And with her usual enthusiasm, she latched on, and I brushed up on my crocheting skills, and off we went. I started to get emails, kind of how to do a march, because I'd never done one before, Twyla had never, and it sounded a little bit like we were going off to war. They talked about don't drive into the march, because there will be people that take a picture of your license plate and then can track you. They talked about have your emergency contacts written in Sharpie on an appendage so that if you're not able to say it, somebody can be contacted. Well, Twyla took that a little bit further and decided that she wanted to leave D.C. with all of the things she came with. So she was taking care of all of her appendages should the worst happen. We actually went into Baltimore and spent the day in Baltimore the day before the march, and I'm the dweeb who was counting hats in Baltimore, 24 hours and an hour and a half away from the location of the march, and for those who are interested, there were 12. When we got to D.C., though, you can imagine there were quite a few more. This was on the way in. We got there 4 hours before the march, and by the time we had walked down the mall, we were shoulder-to-shoulder people. It was one of those crowds where you couldn't move. They had to create kind of rivers of people to navigate. There was concerns for safety, but it was the most congenial group I had been in. It was one of those crowds as well where the individuals were out to help each other. There was a gal who, a 20-year-old, of course, who decided she had to see from the top of a tree, fell out, had a closed head injury, but the crowd itself made a human barrier so that the ambulance could get in and take her out. 3 million people around the world on the streets, and there were no arrests associated with the march. One of the things I found most interesting, well, and there is Ms. Twyla representing Kansas. We had to tell several people that no, there was no Toto and no Oz, but we certainly had strong progressive women in Kansas. The signs were one of the most interesting things. They were expressive, they were educated, they were intelligent. And one of the ones, I'm not sure if you can read this, but one of the signs that was most, that caused me the most pause and made me think the most is this one. For those of you who can't read it, there are copies on the back of what it says, but I'll read it for you. Early warning signs of fascism. Number one, powerful, continuing nationalism. Number two, disdain for human rights. Number three, identification of enemies as a unifying cause. Number four, supremacy or rise of the military. Number five, rampant sexism. Number six, controlled mass media. Obsession with national security. Religion and government are intertwined. Corporate power is protected. Number 10, labor power is suppressed. Number 11, disdain for intellectuals and the arts. Number 12, obsession with crime and punishment. Number 13, rampant cronyism and corruption. And number 14, fraudulent elections. As I read that, I thought about where we were today. So, why were we on the streets? What did we want? Equal pay for equal work? Equal rights under the law? Equal standing in family courts? And reproductive freedom? Again, you have to think how those stories would have been different if we had those rights at those times. So, what do we do now? For myself, there are groups locally that are acting. Indivisible KC, Missouri Progress are both acting on the national and local levels to get in contact with your senators and representatives. I'm running for city council in Raymore. I think each of us needs to stand up and make sure that the government that we have is the one that speaks for us. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Come on, stand up. Yes, everybody get the applause here. These are five. Thank you. Thank you so much. And I know there are all of you out there who are equally as brave and whose mothers are equally as brave. The years of pain are over, we hope. Now, the second thing I was going to tell you was that the opinions that we gave here today are not necessarily those of Oasis. I forgot that. We do have copies of What is Fascism back there. We have two copies, one to the list she read and then an annotated list. We have a couple of books for sale and postcards if you want to order the book, and also an invitation. What we can do next is to, and I would like to suggest this, that we gather the women's stories, the mother stories from this group and publish it as our own volume two of We Are Our Mother's Daughters. So I invite you, those of you who have brave mothers, and you all said you did, and those of you who have a piece of advice your mother gave you, and you all said you did, so it shouldn't be that hard to write 10 pages about your mother. And let's get these stories out here, because the more stories we get of what women have suffered, the better we understand what we have to do to hold the line and make more progress. Thank you so much.